Hey everybody, my name is Everett Mohan. You might know me as Aspiring Spike on the internet. I'm back here today to record another modern video for Channel Fireball. Today I'm playing Bant Control, which is a deck I've liked a lot before Neon Dynasty and has actually gotten a pretty exciting new tool that I think has made this deck really, really, really powerful. That tool is March of Otherworldly Light. It's pretty similar card to Prismatic Ending, where you get to exile most non-land permanents. You miss Planeswalkers, but you hit artifacts, creatures, enchantments with mana value X plus one, basically. So while Prismatic Ending, you're spending the same amount of mana your opponent spends. With March of Otherworldly Light, you're usually spending one more mana. But you do have the ability to spend one less mana than your opponent's permanent if you exile a white card to March of Otherworldly Light. And March is an instant when you compare it to Prismatic Ending. And, very notably, March can exile an Urza Saga or Dark Soul Citadel at instant speed for one mana, which is pretty powerful and important right now because there's a lot of Urza Sagas in the metagame. And this card is pretty perfect for specifically this Yorion Bant control deck, because this list has always been really hungry for that extra cheap interactive removal spell. I used to play Antanice in this list back before March of Otherworldly Light, and March like really just fills out the deck perfectly. And you're probably wondering, like, what is the idea behind playing this Bant Yorion list as opposed to like a blue white Yorion list or the four color Omneth deck, or a 60 card Bant deck? And there's a few ideas at play here. One of the biggest ones is that Ice Fang Quaddle is an incredible card, especially in a control deck like this. But Ice Fang's deck building restrictions make it like it's way better to play Ice Fang in a Yorion deck than in a non-Yorion deck. And I know that's kind of unintuitive, but after you play a lot of these lists, you start to understand that your mana in 80 card decks in Modern is much better than your mana in 60 card decks, where not only do you get to play more fetchable tutor targets, like it's basically impossible to fit both Prairie Stream and Glacial Floodplain in your 60 card Bant decks and like have just like smooth mana in general. But these are like both excellent tutor targets in this list. But you get to play more fetchables and you get to play a better ratio of fetches, where we get to play for Strand, for Misty, for Prismatic, for Windswept Heaths. And so your mana ends up becoming a lot more consistent, which is nice. And Prairie Stream is really important in this list, because and Floodplain too, but Prairie Stream is really nice because both Ice Fang and Abundant Growth really incentivize you for fetching a lot of basics. And like Prairie Stream is something that's great in your Abundant Growth Ice Fang deck, but it's really hard to fit in your 60 card deck. So the idea is that like Abundant Growth is also a card that incentivizes you to fetch basics. Ice Fang is a card that incentivizes you to fetch basics. Abundant Growth really helps you fix your mana, makes everything a lot smoother. And then obviously Abundant Growth and Ice Fang also can be flickered for value with Yorion. So I typically think that this Abundant Growth Ice Fang package is much better in Yorion decks. You see this in the four color Omneth deck too, than in 60 card variants. And so this is a big reason to play green. And you know, really this is just a blue-white control deck splashing green for Ice Fang and Growth, and then Endurance in the sideboard. And I know the Endurances in the side look a little weird, but one thing you have to understand when you look at these 80-card control decks is that one of the biggest things you lose is the ability to mulligan to like impactful sideboard cards in specific matchups, where not only are you going to see your sideboard cards less often, because you have more cards in your main deck, you have more chances that these main deck cards are going to be awkward in some matchups, and you're going to need really versatile sideboard cards to come in these matchups. And so Dovin's Veto, Endurance, Dresden are all very versatile sideboard cards that can come in a lot of matchups and like help you remove cards like Spreading Seas, March of Otherwood, like Prismatic Ending, Solitude, Verdict, Force of Negation, which are all cards that can be bad game one. So like it's really important to have these versatile cards, and Endurance is the best of all the versatile cards that you can play. You can bring it in against graveyard decks like Living in the Dredge, Murktide Regent decks, Death Shadow decks, and I also often bring it in control mirrors, so I don't have to have all these dead removal spells either. I don't think that I need to necessarily go too deep into like the blue-white control part of the stack. You know, Spreading Seas, already a staple in the 60-card control decks, very good to flicker with Yorion for value. Our counterspell Archmage's Charm is a total staple. Fort Teferi makes a lot of sense in the 80-card version as opposed to 3 in the 60-card version. Really, like, the one weird thing here is the four copies of Jace the Mind Sculptor. This is definitely not where I expected to be, but I was playing a lot of this deck before Neon Dynasty. And originally I had four Memory Deluge in a list very similar to this. The Memory Deluge is very good, of course. But I initially realized I wanted the first Jace instead of the fourth Deluge, see how that felt. And then as I was playtesting it over time, I realized that like one specific thing about this Bant deck is you have four Abundant Growth, four Ice Fang, four Spreading Seas. All these cards just say draw a card when they enter the battlefield. And when you have these cantrip effects with no selection, these control decks are really prone to be to mana flood. It's a lot easier to flood if you have a lot of these decks effects that just say draw a card. And Jace the Mind Sculptor is the best way, I think, to just like slam the card, shuffle away two lands and keep going. And you know, the best card advantage to mitigate that. I've actually like just gone from zero Jace to one to two to three, and now I'm just up to the full four. And I've been really, really liking Jace in this deck. And I also like generally think that Jace is like pretty decently positioned in Modern, especially like with access to cards like Solitude, March of Otherwind Light, Force of Negation, more forces post board. But like, you know, you get to fill up in cards with Jace, and then you get to maybe March and exile like two or you know, four mana permanent, exiling some cards, but you get to keep your Jace, or Solitude, pitch a card, you get to keep your Jace. That's been pretty relevant. So I should also note that in my last three leagues with this deck, I'm 14-1. I've trophied my last two leagues with this deck. I'm pretty excited for it. I'm probably going to play it in the NRG event in Chicago this weekend. But without any further ado, I'd like to remind you that this video is brought to you by the Channel Fireball Marketplace, your one-stop shop for singles and magic cards and accessories. You can support your local game stores on there. And you can also support me if you want to use code SPIKE at checkout. So without any further ado, I'll see you guys in match number one. Okay, so we are on the draw for the first match of this league against a Lurrus deck. I think I'm going to keep this hand. I don't love it. I don't love being on the draw with double counter spells. And March can be a bit worse on the draw in these matchups, especially if you don't have access to Urza's Song as a target for March. But thankfully, they don't have a Channeler or Ragavan to play on turn one. It could be the case, like if we're playing against Jund's Saga, which it kind of looks like because of Verdant Catacombs, it could be the case that I'm supposed to shock so that I can exile a Urza's Saga here with March. It's also true, like, there's a pretty good chance if I do that, then I'm just taking two damage for no reason. And I think it ends up being pretty close, to be honest, between those two options. They have played a Voidwalker here on turn two, which is fine. Could potentially be like a black-green rock deck. At the very least, all I think I should do here is just play a Castle Vantress and pass. Don't see any real reason to shock in one of my two breeding pools yet. Both breeding pools in the opening hand. Pretty cool to see someone playing with the non-Full Art Neon Dynasty lands. Like the Full Art ones are really, really nice. I've been playing with them personally. But these lands are also really good too. I'm glad to see them getting some love. So maybe we can go counterspell into March on the Voidwalker. I think we're going to try to do that. See if they have another two drop to play. Yeah, it looks like Green Black Reclaimer. A deck that is like, for some reason, picking up some popularity. I don't truly understand why, to be honest. So I feel like if you want to play like, I feel like the just splashing red for, you know, like the Jund's Saga deck is better than the Green Black version, but I will concede that the green-black version is a little bit cooler. Okay, I'm going to march the Voidwalker main phase so that they do not have a window to... so they did not have a window to cast a counterspell at the Voidwalker. And I actually think that I should... Oh, you know what? I guess if I was going to pitch a card here, then I should have just solituded and not had the shock in the breeding pool. I think I want to have Counterspell up. I guess I can just pass. Like, if my opponent plays Urza's Saga pre-combat, I'll probably just, like, Solitude, pitch Teferi, exile this, then exile the Saga with the March. But because I'm exiling this, I guess I don't need to kill it right now. Okay, they didn't play a They didn't play a Saga pre-combat. I'll just go ahead and Solitude now. And I'm going to, you got to make sure the spot that, I guess it doesn't actually matter very much because the Voidwalker's tapped, but if you don't want the Solitude Exile of the Void counter, you have to stack it like this, where the ETB trigger, or the Exile trigger resolves before the Evoke trigger does. So we got Counterspell up. Would love to like Counterspell a Tarmogoyf for something like that. Probably not Counterspelling a Bauble. All right, wish granted. It kind of seemed like they had that last turn, and maybe they were like a bit afraid of Supreme Verdict. But if we can Jace the Mind Sculptor on an empty board, we're going to be really happy. Bundlegrowth will be nice if we need fixing for Devil White, or later in the game when we go for Yorion. But this turn, I'm definitely just slamming Jace, brainstorming. Okay. So let's go ahead and put Prairie Stream on top and then hide Teferi on top of our library from a Thoughtseize effect, or really just Thoughtseize. Thoughtseize or Turok potentially. And then we can cast it off to Prismatic next turn. And then, yeah, we'll probably cast Teferi before brainstorming with Jace. Kind of depends on, I guess, what my opponent does this turn. I kind of think that they might be close to out of threats. They might just go for Lurrus here. Wow, Soul Transfer. The new Hero's Downfall variant that is that exiles the target instead of destroying. It's a sorcery speed instead of instant, though. But if you have a creature, if you have an artifact and enchantment, you can return a creature or Planeswalker from your graveyard to your hand. And they don't. We get a forest here with double abundant growth. Doesn't matter really too much, probably. They don't currently have a... The way they turn this on is probably just Urza Saga. I don't think they have another way to. Okay, but they've got three cards in their hand. If they have another Soul Transfer, we're still in pretty good shape because we get to go Growth, Yorion in hand next turn. You know, we got a 2-for-1 off the first Soul Transfer. We'll get a 2-for-1 off the second one. They got a 2-for-1 off the Solitude, I guess. All right, takes the Prismatic Ending pretty quickly. There is a pretty good chance we untap with Teferi. I mean, I don't know like how many Soul Transfers you can realistically afford to play in Modern. You know, like Vindicate is a card that sees almost no play. That is, you know, a bit more versatile. The 3-mana 1-for-1. Although, you know, this is Exile, and this does, you know, you can turn this into a 2-for-1. Okay, so they choose the Drain for 2 mode, and then Mill return the land, and the land they return is Verdant Catacombs. And then they pass back. So we're looking like in pretty good shape. Still at 10 life. Nice healthy life total. But as a stop in the upkeep, my read is that they have Baseju and they're thinking about Basejuing my Castle Vantress in my upkeep, but there's really just no reason to do that right now. They could have Besieged also, though, in response to my, cast the Jace. They could have Besieged in response to the Abundant Growth cast, which would have been fine. So maybe my read is wrong. Maybe they didn't see the line. I think I'll hide the Solitude from a Thoughtseize. Oh, but yeah, sorry, if they have Besieged, I shouldn't be. Or if I am reading they have Besieged, I should just put both lands on top. But I think my read was wrong. They almost definitely have Besieged in their deck. I will say, like, my pretty limited playtesting Besieged in, like, Jund Saga and like a red-green Traverse deck that I haven't really found the card to be, you know, like it is obviously like very strong in Tron and Belcher and Oopsal spells, but it's like not crazy good against Titan, and I haven't found that it like really feels like it drastically alters too many matchups besides those three decks I listed. Okay, Weatherbloom Command to destroy my Abundant Growth and return Urborg to their hand. Probably can beat that. They put Lurrus in their hand. I don't know. This is obviously like always the most demoralizing position to be in like your opponent's seat. Gotta respect him for playing it out though. Okay, I'm going to shuffle here. I think I'm grabbing Prairie Stream. Oh, sorry, I should have got a basic for Ice Fang. Doesn't really matter though. We are officially in garbage time, I think. I guess I'll cast another Spreading Seas. In that stage of the game where we really just can't take actions at random. My opponent cannot come back. One card in their hand. This is also like a position I find myself in a lot where I think that players are pretty conditioned to do what my opponent's doing, which is fine, playing it out. And like a big part of the reason why players play it out in spots like this is because Magic Online has a chess clock and you are very much incentivized to play as fast as possible and use as little amount of time on your clock as possible. But I'm up 3 minutes on my opponent here, so it's not as relevant as it would be in other spots. Maybe they identified that with the concession there. So I like Dress Down. Dress Down's kind of nice against Tarmogoyf and Urza Saga tokens. I probably don't need to sideboard too heavily. I think I just mostly want to get the Force out of there. I want the Verdicts. I played this matchup earlier. I trimmed a Verdict, like not really exact. I thought they were, I won game one. I thought they were Death Cloud because I saw a Golgari Rot Farm, and I trimmed some Verdicts, but that was a mistake. I think I'll just play one Dress Down over the Force and submit this. I don't think we really need to reinvent the wheel very much, because as you saw game one, this matchup is pretty lopsided in our favor, I think. On the draw. Okay, I like this hand well enough. I like to be able to answer Reclaimer, or I guess that's really the only one drop they have on turn one. We've got Spreading Seas for Urza Saga. Definitely a hand to like. Opponent with multiple options for turn one, it seems. So that likely means discard spell or Reclaimer, right? As an option for turn one. They do have the discard spell, it looks like. Oh, nope. Shadow Spear is the turn one play. A card that I'm actually kind of surprised to see still in their deck post board. I think that usually I like to trim the Shadow Spear against blue-white decks. But it can also be like pretty easy to forget to trim the Shadow Spear, admittedly. I know I've done it. Okay, so they're going to play Golgari Rot Farm, and then I think they're playing Reclaimer too. Like this is like not even really a consideration to Prismatic Ending. Spell Bomb is also pretty ineffective against me. I don't really have anything that uses my graveyard. Again, like I said in the deck tech, I at one point had Memory Delusion the deck, but no longer. And that Rot Farm is definitely looking like a pretty good Spreading Seas target. think I might just get an island here. I didn't bring an endurance, so I don't need to like really think about getting double green. Which can be a problem with some hands, getting double green for endurance, but it's just a pretty important sideboard card overall. Best case scenario, they just play a Saga, an Urza Saga, and then we just spreading seize them out of the game. Instead, they have a Tarmogoyf here. I'm probably just Teferi bounce the Tarmogoyf. I think I like that. Definitely the most mana efficient play, and this sets me up to go spreading seize plus Prismatic Ending this next turn. Super lopsided game, I think. We'll see. Don't need to count my chickens too quickly. Okay, so I think we're going to still be enacting that game plan of, Okay, I guess I would probably prefer to Ice Fang block the Goyf while I have the Teferi in play. Remember, Floodplain is a snow land, so my Ice Fang does have Death Touch. And this is something, so like, it looks like we just have the instant speed ending up with the Teferi. But I think that Ice Fang always gains a lot of value when you have, when you have Teferi in play, so that way you can flash it in combat, and there's never a window for your opponent to kill it with a removal spell. Urborg, definitely the best land my opponent could have here, since this allows them to filter their mana pretty well with double spreading seas. I guess now with them playing around Ice Fang, I should probably ending. Well, they're attacking me. They're attacking me. I've got two Ice Fangs. I think I'll just go ahead and do this. I don't really care if they gain the life. And they can handle more problematic permanents too. Next turn we can go Teferi into Ice Fang potentially, or Teferi into ending. Voidwalker. Okay, can't Ice Fang that. I guess we should play Fountain over Heath. No, I can play Heath and actually just tap it for black. But the reason to not play Heath would be that when we sack the Heath, it does go to the graveyard, which they could potentially main phase Thoughtseize, and we would ending in response, and then they would they could main deck phase Thoughtseize, we would ending the Voidwalker in response, and then they could sack the Voidwalker to play the Heath and just get a little bit of value off the Voidwalker. But if we play a land that doesn't go to the graveyard, then we do get to deny that tiny piece of value. And because there's no cards in exile, we don't need to like cast this ending immediately or anything, but you know, it wouldn't be too bad to cast the ending earlier since we are committed to casting it. So they've got three cards in their hand. There's an Urza Saga. I can bounce one of my Spreading Seas and move it over to the Saga to deal with that pretty easily. Okay, kind of surprised to see Torpor Orb. We do have an Ice Fang in our hand. We also have plenty of answers to Torpor Orb, and this only affects, you know, eight cards in my deck, my 80 card deck. Not really so big of a deal. I guess for mana efficiency's sake, we just get to go March Exile the Urza Saga for one mana, and then we get to go Teferi Brainstorm, or should Jace Brainstorm hold up Archmage's Charm. My opponent also didn't put Lurrus in their hand, and they definitely had three extra mana laying around, so seems like a bit of a mistake. I think we have successfully re-entered garbage time. Cycle their spell ball. I guess that's what they wanted to do with their mana instead. That's definitely shown that they like to play it out. If they have a card like Turok in their deck, then it's probably a bit more reasonable to play it out. Although it is true. The old Inquisition concede. the Torpor turns off the Turok, as I was about to say. Okay, we are 1-0. I will see you guys in round number 2. Okay, also the draw for round 2. Definitely a pretty good keepable hand. We're up against a no companion deck. It's just gone. Wooded Foothills go. We're going to follow their lead with a Snow-Covered Forest. Abundant Growth go. Wooded Foothills go. Likely to be a Cascade deck. Rhinos are Living End. More likely to be Rhinos if it is a Cascade deck. Okay, not either of those. It's just Ponds, I guess. Looks like it at least. I'm definitely going to Spreading Seas the Forest here, which makes the Utopia Sprawl fall off. If we get Blood Mooned, I'm not sure how we feel about it. It's maybe better to pass with Counterspell up. So we only have one source of colored mana. We can only Prismatic Ending on 2 at the moment. All right, 4-3 Bone Crusher. This is a spot where March of Otherworldly Light would be better, I guess. We do have, you know, a lot of good draws. March of Otherworldly Light, Abundant Growth, Basic Land. I think our deck is generally pretty good against Blood Moon, but we don't have that much time. They've got a Bone Crusher. They have another turn. Now they have 2 Blood Moons. And we still can't do anything. Yeah. That's game over. Yeah, I think maybe I got a little too greedy with the Spreading Seas there. Even like Spreading Seas on my own card would have been a bit better. The Solitude at the very least buys us time. It doesn't seem like they have any more pressure in their hand. Obviously, they've got a lot of top decks that are good. And we like don't have very many top decks. We need to draw like a basic land, like 2 basic lands, or a Spreading Seas is not that bad of a draw because this is actually going to potentially unlock some of my hand because I can like Spreading Seas one of these. Yeah, but just like any amount of pressure is gonna be tough. Third Blood Moon. Yeah, I think at this point, even drawing an island is too slow. Fast game 1. Playing against Ponza. This may also be a matchup where you don't want to sideboard too much. I do think our deck is generally solid against Blood Moon. I could have done a better job around playing around it there, as you saw. I think I would just kind of like the second or third Force of Negation, at least 2. I tend to not like Jace very much against Ponza, or like historically I haven't, but I think I need like still 3 as like sources of card advantage. Maybe I don't. Maybe we could just cut 2 copies. I'm gonna try this. Yeah, but like with their Lightning Bolts and Bloodbraid Elves, Jace is like usually the card that it kind of seems a little weak in this matchup. Okay, hopefully things go a little better here. I mean, I'd love to lead on Forest Abundant Growth against Ponza, but we only have 1 land. Okay, we can keep this one. I can put back the Temple Garden. It's kind of close. If I want the Temple Garden, I can maybe get it off the Heath. I would kind of like to get a basic Plains off of it. They have another Utopia Sprawl. Spreading Seas would be a great draw. No Spreading Seas. I will play the Prismatic so that if they do Blood Moon. Well, I'll counter Blood Moon this turn, but Shigeki. Jukai Visionary, 2 mana. Return to its owner's hand, look at the top four cards of your library, put a land from them on the battlefield tap, put the rest into your graveyard. Dude, this card sucks. Resolves, I guess. I don't know what the idea is there. If they want to spend two mana, bounce it to their hand, that's fine, I think. I am okay with that. It's a 1/3/2. Do not Veil of Summer me, thank you. Oh, sorry, they missed, it looks like they clicked through their attacks incorrectly there. Rough stuff, we've all fallen victim to the old Magic Online interface before. Spring Seize is great here, not only to, oh, that's a great draw too, awesome. Yeah, Seize is good here, not only to get rid of the Utopia Sprawl, hurt my opponent's mana, but it's also good here to flicker to Yorion in a couple of turns, hopefully. I don't think I'm going to Ice Fang and try to block this guy. Yeah, I mean, if they just want to activate this and replay it, that's fine. Pia and Kieran Nalar. No way. Not today, Pia and Kieran. I prefer not to trade Ice Fang for this so I can flicker the Ice Fang with Yorion. What are they gonna get with Karn? I wonder. Maybe just a coding. I'm not sure. Hopefully something cool. I used to play a Ponza list a lot like this with Pia Kieran. It was before Karn was printed. But I had a really good time with it. Okay. They have three cards in their hand. One of them is Liquid Metal Coating. Could move the Spreading Seas over to one of my lands for Blood Moon. Oh no, sorry, I forgot to click the Ice Fang. Oh, it's such a big punt. It's busy debating the merits. I think I shouldn't. I think I need to keep this for double whites. Well, down a card. It's okay. I can maybe bounce my own Yorion with Otara or Otawara. And hope that that helps. Not too afraid of Liquid Metal Coating. I'm not gonna like Force of Negation it. If they just wanna like, if they wanna turn their card into a six mana Stone Rain, be my guest. Yeah. Are they going to activate this? This is like not the first time I've seen this card in a deck list. I do not understand it. It just seems so bad to me. It's like 2 mana 1/3s in Modern, like have to like they have to do something when they enter the battlefield. But this, like, I don't know, man. Maybe an amulet? Even then. But I mean, this is not the only opponent I've seen registering this card, but maybe somebody in the comment can explain if there's something I'm missing. Could be something. They're activating it. I mean, they put a forest into play. And they mill another one. Dude, I haven't seen a Gargaroth in a while. I like Gargaroth. Why don't you just play Rinnan 6? Thorn of Amethyst. That's kind of interesting. I don't really think I need to counter that. Just play this next as a land, I guess. Fury. Let's counter the Fury. So that costs 4 mana. I can't play that and anything else, really. We know the hand is just one of these in a mystery card, though. I think that I will... I'll just attack with both here. Or maybe I just hit it with the Yoria and just have it be a 4-turn clock. That could be a little bit better. Plays around like Ragavan, Bloodbraid Elf a bit better. So this looks like this is probably a card in the Great Creator target that they maybe boarded in over like Lightning Bolts. Definitely not a sign of strength to play the Sprawl on a top land. I think I like countering that. Wait, is this not the last card? Yeah, why didn't they play this? Maybe they think they can't because of the Thorn? I'm not sure. I think at this point I don't need to like really worry about too much. Okay, now I can get my basic forest. I'll force the Thorn on the way down too. I think. Maybe I don't need to. I can pitch the verdict to forest. I'm probably not going to verdict this game. So maybe I should just Plast, actually. Yeah, but like saving this in case they go like Thorn first and then Karn could be good. Although now I just know their hand. It's Thorn plus Shigeki. Okay, there's no way this... Oh, so are they... Oh, they're trying to channel this. Okay, maybe that's what I'm missing. The fact that you get to channel this for value after you bounce it to your hand. Okay. So, like, it ramps yourself, and then you get to channel it. Not sure that I'm feeling it still. It's maybe better than I thought. I'm going to say shock so I can... March a Gargaroth end of turn. Yeah, so how many cards do they get? It costs 6 mana for 2 cards, 8 for 3, and 10 for 4. So they get 3 back. They get Fury, Gargaroth, Eternal Witness. Okay, that is a lot of value. Kind of cool. Pretty slow card, though. Yeah, I didn't really realize how the, like, bouncing it to its hand and the, like, the channel modes worked well together. It's pretty cool. So they get back Pia Kirin, which they cast. And they play a Thorn. So I can exile a token and then attack with both of all of my creatures. No, I need to save this for the Gargaroth, I think. Although that should get the job done. Good top deck. So go to game 3. It's an interesting Ponza variant. I guess Endurance would be like the craziest blowout against that card. That being said, I could just probably remove it with a removal spell, and getting double green in this matchup can be kind of tricky. Yeah, I think I'll just resubmit. I'm not that scared of that card. I think Eternal Witness too. The four toughness is kind of nice, but I also think again, not committing to not needing double green is pretty good too. We can keep this. If they have a turn two Blood Moon, we can get a Plains for March and then try to exile the Blood Moon with the March. But instead we drew, best case scenario, really, my opponent didn't have a one man Accelerant, which is always something, you want to have happen. And we drew a Growth, which is one of the best cards in this matchup, or at least against the Blood Moons. I think I'll just pass back here. Unsurprisingly has a 3-drop. We'll see which one it is. It's Blood Moon. So I can march to exile the Blood Moon this next turn, pitching the Teferi. Or pitching that Teferi. We'll see. Let's play the Glacial Floodplain then this turn, since this lets us basically have the Floodplain enter untapped. Any other turn, it's going to enter tapped effectively. Okay, so they're destroying, yeah, with them destroying a land, I should exile this. So, Blood Moon goes, Pillage kills my forest, then we draw. I'm going to play Teferi and Pless, and no attacks, I think. And what's cool about Teferi in this matchup is also that it stops Bloodbraid from cascading into anything. An interaction that like used to be pretty relevant, Teferi stopping Bloodbraid, and just over time you've seen less and less Bloodbraids in Modern, and until this point where it's just really not that popular of a card. And now I can bounce the Blood Moon. Okay, it's probably worth it to take this turn to become insulated to Blood Moon. Hopefully that's all they play again next turn. We're in pretty good shape, I think. Although I guess if they Blood Moon, this goes back to a mountain, right? Pretty sure that's how that works. So I was supposed to wait on the Spreading Seas until after the moon was in play. But I also have Prismatic Ending for the moon. Pulse of Rasa, main phase to return Wooded Foothills. That's a bit odd, too. Yeah, it's just taps for a red. Okay, I can just pass here with instant speed ending up. Yeah, I feel like that's a waste of the pulse. I don't need any lands here. I think they're just kind of like flooded out and want to cast their spells, use their mana. Okay, that doesn't do anything. Yeah, Blood Moon and Thorn is a bit... It's kind of a Nombo, right? Maybe Nombo is harsh. Yeah, maybe Nombo is like a bit of an exaggeration. But it's like when you're Blood Mooning your opponent, like they've got the mana to pay. You know what I mean? Oh. They're just mountains, but they have the mana to pay for the Thorn. I feel like those two cards just don't play that well together. It's not like a huge deal though. I also like do I have always kind of thought about Thorn of Amethyst, and I do generally feel like the card could see more play than it does, more than like, you know, basically zero. Hopefully they don't have Bolt, but maybe the Thorn taxes their mana if they do have Bolt. Bloodbraid, reveal Utopia Sprawl. Cost them an extra mana here. Mana neutral. Their hand is Gargaroth Mystery Card. OK, Okay, let's Solitude, Pitching the Verdict, exile the Bloodbraid Elf, and I know that this leaves me without a like true answer to the Gargaroth, but I mean I also have Teferi in play. I'm just like don't really think we're gonna get got by it. It's a 5-mana. It's a 5-mana creature that they have to spend a lot of time on tapping with. I think we'll be okay. There's more ways to bounce it. Okay, so because of the Thorn of Anathist, I'm unable to play the 5-mana Teferi, but I can play the 3-mana Teferi at the low, low cost of 4-mana. They have another Bloodbraid Elf. The Cascade from Bloodbraid Elf is stopped by Teferi the Time Raveler, but they do get to kill my Jace. Not the end of the world. And then play a Bone Crusher. Their hand is just a Gargaroth. This turn seems like it's pretty clearly a good turn to go for Yorion, since it isn't cost more from the Thorn, and I get to draw a lot of cards. And I should have probably minus the Teferi because I get to reset most of the loyalty. But I do get to draw 3 cards. Kill the Sprawl, I guess. And the 4/5 creature is, you know, pretty good on the board too. Plays the Gargaroth, which has just gotta feel so bad, into the Teferi. Gotta feel so bad. Now we've got Archmage's Charm up. I'm trying to think I'm not gonna counter the Gargaroth. I'll just bounce it again. Maybe they'll kill the Teferi. Sorry, excuse me, the Teferi here. Which is fine, I'll just bounce it with a Odawara next turn. I have another Teferi. I guess I'll counter a Karn though. Probably don't need to. Seems fine. And they pack it in, thankfully, for the length of this video, huh? See you guys around number 3. Okay, I'm on the play for round number 3. Yorion's still the companion, playing against another non-companion deck. Gonna keep this hand. See if they've got a 1-mana creature or if we're going to be able to bury them with some counter spells. No 1-mana creature, feeling pretty good about that. Don't mind a Hero of Dominaria. Definitely a little bit of tension with the Prismatic Vista here. We really want to get both a blue and a white land because of Charm and Teferi. Oh, we're playing against Goblins. Wow. Goblins is a deck I've actually been playing a lot of lately, a deck I like a lot right now. Let's probably try to draw 2 in a turn or hold up Charm. Not really sure how this matchup is. I think Goblins is usually favored against control. I think that I'd probably guess that we're not a favorite here. This is probably going to get them a Ringleader. I think we just let it go. And then Ice Fang end of turn and maybe try to counter the Ringleader. Yeah, obviously if they have a Cavern, it's awkward. But if they had Cavern in hand last turn, they probably would have played it. So I think we can hope they don't have one. And I'll leave back the Ice Fang to block. Yeah, Ringleader is definitely the card you want to have not resolve if you can help it. Also a good matchup for our 4 copies of Dressdown. Even if they have Cavern, we get to Dressdown the Ringleader ETB. Love to draw a land next turn and just get to go Teferi into Ice Fang. See if my opponent offers a trade. They do not offer the trade. I did get my wish though, so let's go. We can go Basic Plains into Prairie Stream here. And then just the Teferi being in play is really going to pressure my opponent to get a lot of pressure down. Maybe they'll commit a couple creatures into a Verdict here. In which case, we won't We won't play the second Ice Fang if we feel like we're about to verdict. Slinking Lieutenant. Yeah, that's probably enough for a verdict. It's definitely correct to attack here. There's also like probably a decent point to be said for the fact that my opponent's life total doesn't really matter that much, and it would probably be fine to just not waste everybody's time attacking. But for the sake of the video, I guess I'll attack. And I need to have Counterspell Ice Fang up, feeling pretty good about our position. Feeling pretty good. I think we can let this go and maybe like Teferi Time Raveler bounce the token. Ice Fang trade for the other half after they don't pay Echo. So they're pausing here. This definitely makes me think they have Munitions Expert, so I'm actually not going to crack the Misty so I can try to counterspell Munitions Expert if I want to. Like, I think I probably do want to. Probably should have tapped the Mystic Gate though. We can go ahead and cycle Spreading Seas, which would be nice for whenever we go for our Yorion. Do not mind drawing a Solitude either. Okay, they're not paying. They go up to four cards in their hand. We're obviously in a very commanding position, feeling really good. Goblins is definitely the kind of deck that can outgrind in almost any situation with cards like this exact card, Goblin Reclaimer. And it does have, you know, access to the combo kill with Conspicuous Noob Harbinger. Very scary deck. They only find a Slinging though. But yeah, also a deck that can like really need a top deck sometimes, and just sometimes just top deck a Slinging when they need more. Happy enough to take that trade. And then the Slinging is going to be, it's a bit weird. I think I'm actually going to Jace minus on the token. I want to ultimate my Teferi hero. And then this lets me have Pit Solitude plus Archmage's Charm up. They actually just concede to that. The ultimate sign of strength. Jace minus on the token. So here in this matchup, I'm definitely going to cut the Force of Negation. And I think I'm cutting Spreading Seas in favor of Dress Downs. Endurance is kind of interesting just as like a nice blocker in this matchup. Like, I'm not too keen on these Teferis either. Really play like one Spreading Seas as like a potential out to Cavern. Maybe two Spreading Seas, three Endurance. I kind of like this. But yeah, I think that this Teferi is kind of medium in this matchup. Okay, on the draw. Not a very good hand. I think I'll try it though. Den of the Bugbear. This is likely me. I was playing a Goblins list with Den of the Bugbear pretty recently. I've been liking it a lot. I don't know if they're I think that they're probably playing that list, would be my guess, but it's hard to say for sure. Or maybe they started from it. They could have made some changes, of course. That happens a lot. Mostly helpful for me to like think about the fact that my list wasn't playing any Blood Moons or in the sideboard. Last time I played it, I was playing Obsidian Charmaul, because this was like before Neon Dynasty and Tron was like pretty popular and Titan wasn't that popular, but now Titan's really, really popular. And if I were going to play Goblins, I'd be playing four Magus of the Moon in the sideboard. Okay. So they do get the Ringleader, which is not great for us. I was about to say, wouldn't it be great for us unless we drew like exactly dressed down? We might have actually dressed down and like cast Solitude. So we could like block a Goblin token here. Get a 3-2 lifelinker in play. Pretty lucky. Drew a green card, we're maybe like super, super lucky. Okay, not super, super lucky. No, oh yeah, can't attack because no haste. Yeah, I think it's fine to just get the 3-2 lifelinker in play. We don't get to gain life off this, but we do get to eat a Goblin token and Interesting. Yeah, that draw is kind of throwing me off here. Let's Jace plus two, I guess. I think I'm going to plus two on myself. And let's bottom the Archmage's Charm. Yeah, but Jace plus two definitely incentivizes my opponent to commit a little bit more onto this board. They can activate the Din to kill the Jace, but then I'd be pretty happy with that because I actually get to trade Din for the Solitude and then Verdict without them having access to the Din. Crater Maker. Okay, I wasn't playing a Crater Maker, so they definitely made some changes. Right, easy, kill Jace, right? They've got three cards left. I'd really like to try to leverage this Verdict if I can. Man, if I had the Verdict in hand, like it's just like so easy to not pitch the Solitude there. We, you know, drew it right after. Drawing the second Verdict here also just kind of makes my decision not that hard, which is nice. Din of the Bugbear, very good against this matchup, though. I'm honestly, like, we'll see what their follow-up is here, if they have anything else. But I would be I would hope that they've got something else, because, yeah, the Din is so powerful. I feel like it would have been correct for them to not just play the War Marshal, which they obviously didn't here. They were pretty forced into Verdicting again. My opponent is going to drain me for four, probably, and then just get a Goblin token from the Mog War Marshal. And then... so they sacked the Marshal? Okay, so they just want to drain an extra time. That's maybe correct. That's maybe correct. They get an extra damage this way, effectively, but they lose the Goblin token. I'm not sure. So I'm down to eight. The Din puts me to four. I have Endurance to block the Din. My opponent has no cards in their hand. Not doing too bad. Oh, well, that was a good top deck. Into Munitions Expert Skirk Prospector. I think we're going to lose. Maybe if I draw like exactly Solitude, but even then they've got the Expert now. Oh, no, I drew the Solitude. Well, I guess if they activate the Din, then I keep saying that turn after turn these draw better stuff. Yeah, but if they activate the Din, which I guess they probably will do, we may be fine. Kind of surprised they didn't cast the Prospector. There's Prospector, Expert, Mystery card. Close game. They cast the Prospector. So is the idea that they can... No, they can't. They can't activate Din and Munitions Expert. So I guess what I should do here is Endurance. Don't I shuffle these cards back into my library? I guess I kind of would. Not a huge deciding factor. But endurance and block. It's wild how every turn, like, them activating Din would be so good for them. They just have something better to do each turn. But this, we do get to trade endurance for the ringleader here and the munitions expert ETB. Then we untap. Draw Prismatic Ending. Not a super valuable card here. I'm just going to pass. I really hope they activate the Din this turn and I get to exile with Solitude. And block a 1-1 with the 3-2 lifelink. We're not quite that lucky. So my opponent plays a Boggart Harbinger instead. They could get Sling Gang, they could get another Ringleader. They get another Ringleader. We really want them to attack now. I guess I can Jace Pless and get rid of the Ringleader next turn. Pretty likely to do that. Solitude, exile this, block here if they attack, then ending here plus Jace. Then the Din is still a problem though. We don't know what their mystery card is either. I don't feel like it's super relevant, but it could be. Notably, if their last card is a goblin, we could counter it with Charm, since they tapped their Cavern to Harbinger. So I'm surprised they're in the tank for this long on the attack, to be honest. They've lost connection and they've rejoined. You can't see that on your screen, I guess, but I can see it hiding under here. Wow! Okay, mystery card was Aether Vial. Makes sense. We're still taking on the attack. Okay. Decides no attacks. Whoops. Okay, so I can go exile here, and if I attack, I go up to 7, but then they can kill my Jace. Pretty sure I just exile this, slam Jace, play Vista, I guess. Then put the Ringleader on the bottom and hope to fade a top deck. They have been drawing pretty well besides the Aether Vial. I mean, why do they have Crater Maker in the deck? Now I'm thinking about it. It's got a weird card to board in. Maybe it's in the main deck. Finally, the Din gets activated. I'm not sure if I'm blocking it or not. Like, I might just eat the token. Gain 3, let Jace go to 2. Kind of don't hate that. Three life gives me a lot of breathing room. They drew Cavern for turn. Backup Jace, not too bad. I think I'll just put back the two charms. I could draw one of the two charms, I guess, which is actually kind of good. Yeah, it's a steal to Vile. I get to Vile in the Ice Fang if I want it. They should tap the Vial in response. We'll see if they have the patience to. If they kill my Jace this turn, it obviously doesn't matter that much because I just have another Jace in hand. They chose not to use Vial's ability. I guess I'm just not gonna steal them. Good play. Jeez, like I got. You have a Snoop on top? Oh, it's a Matron. Okay. Can't counter the Matron. So they do have a Ringleader in the deck to get, which I'm assuming is being gotten now. They're still not in great shape for whatever that's worth. They hit a Snoop and then a Matron here. It's pretty good hits. Definitely, I'm going to want to steal that Vial, I think. Reduce that mana production. Or maybe it is better to Ice Fang block so I can keep my Solitude. Let's steal the Vial. Them getting to Vial in the Stoop next turn is pretty rough. Like Matron is a pretty good. Matron and Snoop can both be very mana intensive cards, so letting them get two mana off the Vial next turn is just not worth it, I think. So let's just start off by Vialing in this. Durance is not bad here. Okay, put Yorion in hand, play land for turn, untap two lands, and pass back. How many Ringleaders have they cast? They've cast three. Last time I played Goblins, I only played three total, so they may be out. That is definitely a good one to have on top. So their hand is currently Goblin Matron, Mystery Card. Wow, they're actually not casting the Expert. Or are they... going to respond to the Matron trigger by casting Expert. That is what's going to happen. So what are they going to target? They target the Teferi. Sorry, board's getting kind of clogged. Let me exile the Snoop in response to the ETB trigger. So the Teferi just takes 4 instead of 5. And they grab another Snoop. Pretty good choice at this point in the game. Right. Turin's looking solid here. Target ourselves. Block, block. Tick our Aether Vial up to 3. Plus, Brainstorm. I haven't done this in a while. I'm just actually going to cycle another Jace. Let's get a little deeper. There we go. Pass it back. Bit Jace flooded. So uncounterable Snoop. Top card is just an unclaimed territory, which is just devastating for my opponent. It'll be March of All the Wither Light can actually exile Den of the Bugbear, where Prismatic Ending can't, because March is not non-land permanence, artifact, creature, or land. Bit weird. Okay, another vial, and with them drawing a land next turn, this is maybe going to be all she wrote. Because they can't really advance their board super well next turn. And we get to keep ticking up our planeswalkers. They see the writing on the wall and they concede to us with the 2-0 victory. We're 3-0 in this league. Hopefully we can continue our win streak. I'll see you guys in round number 4. Okay, we are on the play from match number 4. 2 die rolls lost and 2 die rolls won. This looks like a keepable hand. We're going to lead on Breeding Pool into Abundant Growth. Obviously, this is definitely the kind of hand where if your Solitudes are kind of dead, then we're not going to probably do that well, but you still keep these, I think, in the blind. Okay. Canal Go is pretty likely going to be Murktide. So I think I am going to play Mistigate this turn to hold up Counterspell. The next turn I can maybe get the Glacial Flood Plain. Solitude is if this is Murktide, like I suspect, this is definitely going to be a good matchup for Solitude. We're playing against Storm, I guess. I haven't played against Storm in a long time, dude. I think I'm supposed to let this resolve, right? Or like, I really need to be... I really need to be using my creature removal spells on the creatures. And like, since I have, you know, now 4 creature removal spells and only 1 counter spell. I can Solitude exile. A little bit of lag there. I can Solitude and exile the next creature too. So they're pretty unlikely to be able to go off through a Solitude this turn. Man, I haven't played against, like, I can't remember the last time I played against Giftstorm. Used to be a somewhat common deck in Modern. Has really fallen out of favor. I just noticed my opponent's username is the 302 Storm's, kind of funny. But it's also true that, don't obstructionist me. It's also true that Twiddlestorm is a deck that is still like pretty underplayed, but is a deck that I personally think is great. It's kind of a weird time to cast these Metamorphoses. Yeah, I'm going to cast the Gifts, looks like. I'm going to cast another Metamorphose. All right. Casting the Gifts. We may be sitting here for a while. My opponent selects their Gifts on given pile. I kind of don't think they're going to get the Ritual Metamorphose Pass in Flames. Oh, they do. Okay. I think I want the Passing Flames in the yard so that okay, maybe just counter it. Yeah, let's just put Metamorphose Passing Flames in the yard. So they're out of Metamorphoses too. Kind of early for that. Second counter spell's okay. Obviously can't quite cast it here. I've actually played, you know, Giftstorm in a few GPs. It's definitely a deck I'm pretty familiar with. But it's been a while. Definitely a little bit caught by surprise. So, you know, I wonder if there's something in the metagame that the player likes about Storm, or if they just are a diehard fan. Untap Blue Source would be great. There we go. I have to get a Fountain or Breeding Pool, but it is an untapped Blue Source. That being said, you know, it is like, you know, if my opponent just, if I don't, I have like no pressure on them right now, it's not that hard for my opponent to just kind of sit back and really put a lot of pressure on my mana. Although here, I'm just gonna I think we pitched the March of Otherworldly Light, so the next Solitude can potentially be some pressure. But I'm really thankful that they're going for it here, because honestly, if they just kept waiting and cantripping, we're probably in pretty bad shape. So now the only card we know in their hand is Desperate Ritual. I mean, they have the Pass in Flames in the graveyard. Playing a Baral here. I don't love letting this resolve, but letting this resolve is, like, I think really only that bad against, like, exactly Empty the Warrens, especially since they've used all their mana morphoses. They can't get any blue mana. So I think, like, just trying to counter Pass in Flames is fine. If they have Empty, they have Empty. Oh, they have a Pass in Flames from their hand. That's pretty good. So they have two copies of Pass in Flames in the graveyard. Pretty interesting spot. I think if the last card is a ritual, they'll go ritual, Pass in Flames. And then we'll counter the Pass in Flames, but it looks like it is not. Okay, so let's get a probably just another Breeding Pool, because we have the Mysticate for as much white as we really need. Oh, it could have maybe got Prairie Stream there. It's probably a bit better, actually. What are we doing here? Let's main phase this Ice Fang. If I draw a white card, I'm just going to Solitude the Brawl. I did not draw the white card. I guess I could have Yorion for the white card here. I also don't mind counterspelling a Pass in Flames this turn cycle. Maybe I should mind, though. Because they're not that far from just going off without the Baral. I guess we just hard cast. Yeah, I mean, they need to have ritual, or ritual land next turn to go off with the Pass in Flames. I think it's probably good to exile the Baral this turn. Could have maybe done that last turn too. Been a while since I played in the matchup. My muscle memory is all gone. Because they have a Baral, but they don't have the mana to go off, thankfully. I think I could maybe draw something to change my plan. Looks like I couldn't. If I get to counter this Pass in Flames, though. Yeah, it's almost like lights out. Because they only play two usually. I don't think they're somehow on the three. Maybe they have remand. So nope. It's like it's just so hard for them to combo off with both Pass in Flames exiled now. Not impossible, I should say, but difficult. Getting to Spreading Seas the Islet's kind of nice as well. Then we can just exile the Baral. Attack for five. It would be a bit better to leave up the Breeding Pool as opposed to the Mystic Gate, but I'm just going to be a little lazy. I'm not like really bluffing anything. I feel like somewhat confident. I shouldn't say I feel too confident, but just like, again, with two Pass in Flames from the deck exiled, it's just so tough for my opponent to get anything going. Why are they casting Consider on my upkeep? I guess they have Gifts and they're just trying to see if I'm F6'd. Okay. Weird. I don't know what they're gifting for. Maybe if they have like Wish in their deck, then the things can get kind of scary. I mean, if they have a third Pass in Flames too, like That would obviously get us. I just really doubt it. I've never seen three Passive Flames in Giftstorm. I guess for whatever it's worth, I haven't seen Giftstorm in a long time. Baral, Electromancer, Ritual Shred. I'll just put the mana guys in the graveyard. See if I find a counterspell, which would probably just lock the game up. No counterspell. I think I'll play a Teferi. I don't really feel like I'm stopping too much, but at least it turns off any like remands, which is nice. Sometimes they'll go like grape shot, remand their own grape shot. This at least cuts that off. Or I guess not if they grape shot the Teferi first. All right, five cards in my opponent's hand. Good luck to you. No Metamorphoses, no Passing Flames. Does fire off the Ritual. Ritual. Three cards in hand. Wish for Passing Flames, needs more mana. I like the style. Cast rituals first, ask questions later. We'll figure it out, right? I don't know. We'll see what happens. Okay, one of their three cards is a Steam Vents, which they can shock and go to one, which they've done here. Five red mana floating. I would love to get upheavaled here. Okay, they do have Wish. I wasn't sure if that was in the deck. They have five mana. Passing Flames is going to be short. They're a mana, and thus the last card is a Ritual. Passing Flames is going to be one short because it costs four mana to cast Passing Flames. And they need two mana before they start to cast their Rituals and Metamorphoses again. So we'll see. I'm not even going to look. There's nothing they can hit here. I guess they could hit Graveshot to kill my creatures, but it's not a game-winning line. Okay, we win game one, and we also get to bring in a lot of good sideboard cards. Force of Negation, Dovin's Veto, Endurance, all great in this matchup, I imagine. I'm going to cut the Spreading Seas, and the verdicts are kind of nice against Empty the Warrens. I think I'll trim one March, one Prismatic Ending. They both have their own strengths and weaknesses against the mana creatures. I think I want to keep all the Solitudes. I might just cut the Jaces. Jace seems like really hard to tap out for in this matchup. I don't think I've ever slided out all four Jace before, but I think it makes a lot of sense. At least with Teferi, you get to like play it and untap a land, you know? I don't really like this hand. Probably keep though. Gonna enter to a creature, got a counterspell, got an Ice Fang. I know that the mana is kind of awkward too. This is definitely like the exact kind of hand that you would love a Bant to Triumph for. But Glacial Floodplain doing an okay job fixing our mana. Okay, there's a Brawl. Can definitely use a Prismatic Ending on this one, I think. I mean, if they Blood Moon me, they Blood Moon me. You never got Blood Moon before, kid? Okay, how do we feel about Teferi here? I feel pretty good about it, I think. Uses my mana pretty efficiently. If they have, like, a Mystical Dispute, there's a good chance. Okay, they're a super F6 there. I was just plus. All right, feeling okay. Yeah, Teferi with Solitude up is going to make it pretty tough for my opponent to combo off. Down to land two from the Fire Islet Sec, going to make it even tougher for my opponent to combo off. Just playing a Steven's Tapped. We're looking great here. Okay, Abundant Growth on Island. I'm getting a little risky here. Yeah, there we go. I feel like between the Teferi minus and the Abundant Growth draw, we had a pretty good chance to find a land. I really wanted to find a land too. This definitely feels like a critical turn for my opponent to get anything going. I'm not sure exactly how they can fight through like Teferi plus these counter spells, but it's probably possible. They have 7 cards in their hand. Tapped Steam Vents. Definitely not the sign of strength that they need. Oh, sorry. I should have played Ice Fang, and I like disgustingly got rewarded for not playing Ice Fang because now I can just pitch it to Endurance if I need to. But I should have played the Ice Fang. This is really the last turn. Like, if my opponent can't get anything going here, the game just ends, I think. You just always let Wish resolve there, just counter whatever they wish for. They've already played their land. Guess this resolves. Kind of, I wasn't expecting to see Electromancer here, but I think this is not going to be enough for them. We're missing lands, I guess. I think I'll cycle the Abundant Growth. It'd be great to hit a land. Obviously not the end of the world if we don't. We did hit one, though. So I guess I'm just going to march and hold up 2 counter spells. Not have to go to discard yet. Can play Endurance at the end of turn. Get some more pressure going. We've got 5 cards left in their hand. But we could even beat a big Endurance with like these Endurances and Solitudes. Sorry, but we could beat a big Empty the Warrens. Solitude, like, you know, blocking a token, gaining 3 life every turn. It's going to be kind of tough for Empty to fight through if we have 2 of them. Unfortunately for my opponent, they just can only pass back. It looks like, oh, they're reconsidering. Okay, they're playing a spell. Repeal to Fairy Time Raveler. I guess I'm going to counter that. Could maybe have let it go. I feel okay countering it, I think. Let's actually just keep our Teferi's loyalty high to play around burn spells on it. And I can just go main phase Endurance. So I don't have to go to discard. I can use the mana that would untap with Teferi too. And I've got 2 counter spells up. I've got a lot of Solitudes. Can put more pressure on my opponent on my instep too. Island for turn. Brawl resolves. Respond to Desperate Ritual with a Solitude on Brawl. They can't play any more rituals or metamorphoses in their hand because of Teferi. Storm count is now 3. 4. Yeah, MT is just not going to be enough here. I think I'll let that go. If I counter it and like have MT as the last card, it just contributes to the storm count anyways. I think I'll counter this one. Because if they're wishing for MT, the game just ends. And even if their last card is empty, the Warren's here is just not enough, I think, still. That says GG. And we'll see you guys at round number 5. Okay, so we won the die roll for round number 4. We've got a kind of a bad hand, because in order to play, we can't play Ice Fang on turn 2 and Charm on turn 3. My mulligan. It's also not that good. I guess we'll keep this one, though. This one at least has outs to curve out a bit better. And if we flood out, we at least can Yorion and cantrip a bunch. I think we only had one opponent with a companion this league. Kind of a rarity these days. So Bobbled, no companion, is usually blue-red Murktide. Could obviously be a couple different decks, but... probably Blue-Red Murktide, which is a matchup that I usually like a lot, but it's also Blue-Red Murktide, so any deck is capable of losing to Murktide. We did draw 2 spells in a row. Solitude is pretty good in this matchup too, so feeling okay about our position. Opponent potentially consider... Oh, all three Solitudes in a row is kind of funny. Opponent potentially considering... spell piercing the spreading seas there and deciding against it. That could have been the pause there. I could also just be reading a little too much into the pause. No need to solitude this super aggressively. I do think I'll probably cast the Ice Fang this turn. Obviously, if we just drew land, I was going to Yorion into the hand. Sorry for rhyming. Totally fine if they counter this, and totally fine if they bolt it too. Spell Snare. Okay, I'm a little less fine with the Spell Snare, to be honest. I do feel Spell Snare is a little underplayed in Modern. It's just one of my favorite cards ever. Just like, it always feels so good to cast. Because every time you resolve Spell Snare, your opponent spent 2 mana, you spent 1 mana, and you just get to feel the smartest ever. I think I'm actually just going to main phase draw 2. I can draw Ending for Channeler, and I really feel like I need to draw the 5th land for this Solitudes. Kind of, I assumed that pause was them thinking about spell snaring the Spreading Seas. It's kind of blasphemous to play Spell Snare and Spell Pierce. It's really not expecting that at all. They don't have Delirium yet, though. They do have 4 cards in their hand. Ragavan. I don't think I'm going to Solitude Ragavan here. I'm okay with getting hit by Dash Ragavan. I think that people like fight over the Dash Ragavan way too hard. Like, I've just kind of come to realize like a lot of times it just doesn't do very much besides hit you for 2. That being said, I would be happier to pitch Yorion to exile Ragavan here. And I certainly would rather Solitude Ragavan than Counterspell if those are my 2 choices, since they are just a type away from Delirium. Graveyard, Lightning Bolts. Keeps the card on top, draws two. We're definitely in bad shape. Just like us not finding the land was pretty bad for us. And this is iteration. Okay, it's not iteration. Okay. Interesting. So there's Delirium. I guess I'll Solitude the Ragavan. Definitely happier that I'm not pitching a Solitude, but Solitude and Ragavan also like makes my outs of like Supreme Verdict way better. This is a lot of pressure. Channeler is so good. Spellstare and Spell Pierce. It's just kind of hard to win games like this too. What are you gonna do? We do get to play Ice Fang with Counterspell up. It's not too bad. I was about to say in before second spell snare as a joke, but they are playing two spell snares. Maybe there's geniuses. I don't know. Spell snare is kind of great. Spell snare also handles like a lot of the problematic cards from Murktide 2, Chalice of the Void, Rest in Peace. Yeah, maybe my opponent just cracked the case. They're also main decking Dress Down. Pretty sick. And explosives. And Gutshot. I don't understand. My opponent is just summoning the most random cards. I don't know where are they cutting to make room for explosives and two spell snares and spell pierce and Gutshot and Dress Down. How do they do it? How do they do it? It's awesome. Okay, this is usually how I sideboard. I cut the Spreading Seas for Endurances, and I usually play like one Force of Negation. Okay, let's submit this.
How do they do it?
They also have Charm in their deck. Like, usually, like, a lot of times when you see like a lot of flex cards from Murktide, they've cut Archimage's Charm from the deck, but they cast Charm. Like, typically, Murktide has, like, two or three flex spots. Let's see. Sorry, I don't see my list. But usually, have like, two or three flex spots. But to see, like, five flex cards is so surprising. Okay, we can keep this. Probably getting Temple Guard in here because we have Mystic Gate. I'm actually pretty unhappy to see no one mana creature in turn one when I've got March and Ending in my opening hand. I really want to trade these cards for cards right now. Well, at the very least, I can March a Dash Ragavan. Definitely a pretty relevant thing that Prismatic Ending can't handle. Green Source would definitely be nice for Endurance. And it's definitely an issue you run into matchups like this. Like, I guess really specifically this matchup. Like, you need to have a lot of removal because they win with creatures. But they only play, like, 12 creatures. And so sometimes you draw five creature removal spells early and they just have a counterspell cantrip draw. And you just do nothing. These games definitely don't feel great. Okay, that lets me do something. All right. In before getting subtletied. Obviously, they get a Blood Moon here, and I'm like kind of shields down for it. But that's really the only card to get super punished by. Endurance like slows down their Murktides, makes both their Ragavans and their Channelers pretty bad. They have a really hard time killing this card. I think it's good to jam it there. You know what? I was looking at their game, the game last game, like. I was like, sure they weren't playing Fury. I guess this could be into sideboard, but why would they sideboard it in against the control deck? I don't know. But this is like another card I tend to think of as a flex spot in Murktide. So I'm just like, I just don't know what their list looks like. Which is also like a strength of theirs in the spot is that, you know, I just can't figure out exactly what their list looks like. Notably, they did also miss a land drop last turn, but so do we here. Iteration, we'll see if they can find a land off of this. They exile a Dragon Rage's Channeler, which I guess I'll use. I know I should use Ending on this because I just should save the the March for Dash Dragavan. But now that I get max punished by drawing Jace, but I'm still gonna play it, just try to find a white source. Don't find a white source. I find instead three copies of Counterspell. What a weird game. Just main phase the Solitude, I guess. Don't love it. Yeah, max punish for not marching there, unfortunately. I think it made sense, like with the info we had. Like just like saving March for Dash Ragavan and using Ending on Channeler is just like exactly what you need to do in this matchup. Okay, it's a non-delirious Unholy Heats. Okay, so we'll take the 3-for-1 off Jace, I suppose. Two counters up. Weird game. Easy counter spell. Okay, they've got four cards. I'm drawing up to four cards. I also have Yorion. Just pass back. Love to see a Dash Dragavan here. Okay, they find land number 5. They shock in Steam Vents. Then they play Murktide Regent, which I guess I kind of have to counter. This probably doesn't resolve, but I've got Solitude to exile the Murktide, which probably will resolve. Obviously, I would prefer to just draw land and hardcast the Solitude, get my 2-for-1, but I have plenty of white cards, and I also have Yorion if I want to pitch that instead. But I'll just main phase this, and then have to have Subtlety, which they don't have. So starting to pull a little ahead here. If they have a second Murktide Regent, things could get a little dicey. Could maybe set up to March of Otherworldly Lighted. I'd prefer not to, especially because it's like probably hard to resolve March on X equals 8. And it looks like they do have the 7-7 Murktide Regent, unfortunately for me. I could also try to like flicker Solitude with Yorion, which is probably the better line than trying to like exile the Yorion and X equals 8. I actually exiled a Gristlebrand with March earlier for 1 mana, and it was very relevant that I was able to do it for 1 mana too. Okay, target Ragavan. Down to 9. Well, this doesn't have Death Touch yet. Pretty sure I just jammed the Yorion. Obviously, they could have a counterspell. We at least dodge Spell Snare, Spell Pierce, Force of Negation if they have that. Not that one, though. Two cards in their hand. Down to 7 life. Just Fury? Jace. Jace +2. Fair enough. Pretty interesting card to see here. Let's Ice Fang. They have Spell Snare. Spell Snare is the best card ever printed. So I get to attack the Jace, and I go to one life after they attack me with Murktide. Dude, Spell Snare is so sick. I love that card. Can't even be that mad. Can't even be mad. Yeah, these one mana counter spells are so strong in these matchups. Maybe I'm gonna put it just crack the code. Maybe Spell Snare is just the truth. Like, not only is it a great tempo card, but it also just does help a ton against Chalice and Rest in Peace, which are two cards you're pretty weak to. Okay, down to one. They've got one card in their hand. They're also drawing a card off the Bauble. It's a card they've already seen, though, because they got to Jace. I think no matter what, I fold to a counterspell here, right? Fold to a Bolt. I guess not anymore on the Bolt. I mean, I'm just gonna play the just gonna play the Teferi instead of trying to march X equals 8. Counter target spell, can't march the Murktide, and we lose. Tough stuff. 4-0 streak coming to an end here. I have been doing really well with this deck still, so this means I'm 18-2 out of my last four leagues. Been loving the Bant Control deck. Probably gonna play it in the Chicago NRG event this weekend. Would definitely recommend the 75 to you, and there should be a deck guide, an updated deck guide coming out for it on Channel Fireball. I'm pretty sure I've got an older one out there too, but we'll be updating it with the March of Other Really Light new game plans on CFB Pro. So you guys can check that out there, and I'll see you guys next week for another Modern video.